So welcome everybody. We're very pleased to have Dr. Michael Nelson here for our CERC seminar today. However, in the spirit of advertising, I'd like to talk about our next seminar, which is by a prominent Singaporean academic who works on Singapore, recently moved to Hong Kong. Some of you may have heard of him, Dr. Cherian George, who's now associate professor at the Department of Journalism at Hong Kong Baptist University. His talk is more general, Managing Religious Diversity in Southeast Asia, How Insult Laws Can Backfire. But I think many of you know him for his writings on Singapore as well as the region. And so we invite you very heartily to that seminar as well. But today, as I said, we're very pleased that Michael Nelson is with us. Michael is well known to several people in this room personally, but for anybody familiar with the CERC website, he's been well known for years. Because if I'm not mistaken, Michael, you are the most prolific contributor to our CERC working papers. And anybody who's had a look, and I would advise you, we've had, there are a few copies of the working papers that were distributed earlier, but they're all available online. And if you have a look at some of Michael's working papers, that go, some of which go back several years, they're impressive not just in their analysis, but also in the sheer amount of material they bring together. So we're very grateful for Michael's contribution to our working papers series, and we're very pleased to have you live and in person. And I just found out this is your first trip to Hong Kong.
Yes.
So this is a doubly satisfying, finally bringing you out to Hong Kong, where you've been well known through your contributions here to our center, for which we're grateful. Michael is a senior research fellow at the German Southeast Asian Center for Excellence for Public Policy and Governance in the Faculty of Law at the prestigious Thammasat University. Among his publications are Central Authority and Local Democratization in Thailand, that's 1998, and co-authored with several others, Parliaments and Political Change in Asia, 2005. He's the editor of Thailand's New Politics, 2002, Thai Politics, Global and Local Perspectives, 2005. His current research interests concern the development and operation of Thailand's system of political representation, constitutionalism, which is his topic today, varieties of political culture, provincial level, and administrative structures. That is a lot of detail, but the big picture is Michael is well known as one of the most insightful and also courageous, I might add, thinkers, writers about Thai, current Thai politics. He's never been reluctant to give his opinion, his well-founded views, and we're very pleased that he's dealing with the topic today, which is, of course, great relevance given all the political changes, not necessarily positive ones, that have occurred recently in Thailand. Again, Michael, welcome. Thanks for coming, and thanks for your contribution.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. On the last part, actually a friend called me a few days ago and said, Michael, don't touch on that issue. What issue? 112, invasion of the state. So don't talk about anything touching on the monarchy. He said, in every single seminar, the Thai military has its spies, and we will report back to the embassies, etc. So this kind of talk doesn't appear or occur under normal circumstances, but you must recognize that Thailand is under military dictatorship, and they have been tightening the screws for dissent quite a bit. So the things that appear on Facebook and elsewhere is tightly followed by the powers that be. The second thing I would like to say is I must apologize that I might interrupt my talk from time to time by coughing because I have been battling bronchitis for the past 2 weeks and only just now get a little bit better. The third thing, I was supposed to talk about the Thai draft constitution of 2015, and that was of course bad luck because this draft constitution doesn't exist any longer because the National Reform Council rejected that. So I wondered what should I talk about instead. because I intended to go into some detail about this constitution, but it makes no sense because it's gone already. And the new constitution that will come, that will be proposed probably in January in the first draft and then finished in April 2016. We don't know yet what it will bring because the committee has just started its work. So I thought I might still talk about the 2015 constitution on the draft, but better contextualize this within the context of some broader issues. The first thing I think I will talk about is constitutions and constitutionalism more broadly. We'll then go on to discuss two key limits to constitutionalism or the development of constitutionalism in Thailand, namely the official state ideology of nation, religion, and monarchy, and second, the political discourse of the apichon or the elite. The third point will be about the draft constitution more directly as a means of struggle of the apichon against democracy. The fourth point, I will briefly touch about the process of constitution making before I move to the last one, that is the National Strategic Reform and Reconciliation Committee. That was a very novel innovation in the draft of 2015 and basically led to the abortion of the entire draft by the National Reform Committee. Let me, the beginning will be quite broad, so please bear with me a little bit. Let me begin with a fairly general observation. That there are certain modern expressions, such as globalization, world culture, and world society, denote the expansion of codes, social forms, and their content, respective structures and organizations, and for us in this context, specifically relevant decision-making programs from world centers to world peripheries. As with other elements, the decision-making programs are specific to the function systems in which they are supposed to work. So for example, the economy has prices, school education has curricula, biomedicine has treatment regimes, science has theories, art has styles, and the legal system has laws. All of these are decision-making programs. And all these programs work to guide, essentially, the selection of correct actions within given function systems. The formal legal program of functionally differentiated political systems or liberal democracy is called constitution. So that's the first thing we have to keep in mind. Constitutions are decision-making programs specific to politically functionally differentiated systems. Constitutions were devised to deal with the problem of sovereignty, especially when the previous center had guaranteed the unity of pre-modern states, that is the monarch, had to be replaced. There needed to be an absolute authority that would replace the monarch as the center of the political order, and that is, with Luhmann again, the constitution. There could be no power centers outside, or no power centers within the political system outside of the specific constitutional order. Therefore, constitutional rules are supposed effectively to constrain political institutions, political actors, and political processes. They can do so because the political order is supported, I quote Stone Sweet, a commitment to accept the legitimacy of and to be governed by constitutional rules and principles. In the word of Dieter Grimm, the well-known German constitutional law expert, I quote, "The regulation of political action by the Constitution is comprehensive in the sense that no extra constitutional bearers of power and no extra constitutional ways and means to exercise this power are recognized. Whenever this is realized in any given political order, we speak of constitutionalism." So we have two elements, constitutions as a text and constitutionalism in case constitutions really govern what happens in politics. As with the expansion from the center to the periphery of other functional systems, the behavioral result in peripheral social formations often does not resemble the outcome we would expect given the original societal models. In other words, taken out of their original context, decision-making devices often seem not to program decisions and actions in the way we would expect when we look at the original, mostly Western model. So in the center-periphery transfer, some important elements or components seem to disappear. In the Thai context, foreign observers and Thai observers alike often refer to this difference between model and behavioral reality by saying that the form has been applied, but the content or the spirit has been lost in this transfer from world centers to Thailand. For example, people would complain that formal schooling curricula have been transferred to Thailand without though having the respective result we would expect when we look at Western schooling. Or people would say, we have, of course, scholars at university, but they do not achieve world-level standards of performance because the concept of knowledge in Thailand is different than the knowledge concept that we have in Western-style academic work. Applied to constitutional law, this means that even when constitutions do exist, such as in Thailand, constitutionalism might still remain a variable. That is, it might not be realized. While globalization has, of course, as we all know, led to the application of constitutions basically universally, it has not necessarily produced constitutionalization or constitutionalism. This has led to the question, for example, by Niklas Luhmann, whether constitutions might perhaps be specifically European institutions because of their cultural dependence cannot function elsewhere. Again, with Luhmann, we might say that constitutions are often adopted merely in a symbolic way, or they might be, I quote, used as instruments of a governing elite, for example, a military regime, that does not comply with the intended conditions, but govern unconstitutionally by using the constitution, which is quite an apt description of what we see in Thailand these days. This statement refers specifically to Brazil, but we have other phrases such as constitutions without constitutionalism apply to Africa, or we have a book title, Constitutions in a Non-Constitutional World that apply to the Arab world. This set of issues is considered in a book that was published last year, edited by Olga Chen. It's called Constitutionalism in Asia in the Early 21st Century. Chen wants to go beyond this usual dichotomy of constitutions without constitutionalism in order to assessing the situation of constitutionalism in Asia more broadly. For this, he uses old categories from Löwenstein and Sartori. He then comes up with his own three-step categories. The first one is German constitutionalism, the second is communist socialist constitutionalism, and the third is hybrid constitutionalism. So hybrid constitutionalism, according to a general understanding, means that you have a social system that displays both authoritarian and constitutional elements, and you will not be surprised to hear that Thailand is in the category of hybrid constitutionalism. Of course, this is nothing new to specialists working in Thailand, because we even have a specific expression for that, that is Thai-style democracy. I refer to the first two points, one by a Thai historian, one by Harding and Leyland. The first says, the Thai mindset reveals a strong preference for more tangible but extra constitutional sources of power, such as the military and the monarchy. The second says, there are not three branches of the state, executive, legislature, and judiciary, but five, if we regard both the monarchy and the military as having powers of their own, extra constitutional powers. But it seems that the military and the monarchy are the main institutional counterpoints of Thai constitutionalism, or the possibility of developing constitutionalism in Thailand. They in fact have their very own ideology, or say an ideological support structure that competes with the constitution for the highest value in the political order. This ideological support structure is actively reproduced throughout the state apparatus, and it is widely propagated in schools, etc., in order to shape the minds of the Thai people into that of obedient conformist subjects that are trying to counter the constitutional model of independent-minded citizens. So they try to shape the minds. This refers back to God, who was the Thai mindset, because one would have to ask, where does this Thai mindset, if it exists in this form, comes from? And this is the way it is reproduced, that is by constant, far-reaching ideological influence. This ideology, as you might know already, is called nation, religion, and monarchy. Most basically, actually, most basically, Thais are reminded of this trinity every day, many times, because of the national flag. The national flag represents nation, religion, and monarchy. The nation being represented by the red stripes, the white represents the purity of religion, and the big blue stripe in the middle represents a monarchy. And when you see the flags in Thai everyday life, every time the Thai sees these flags, subconsciously or consciously, you will think nation, religion, monarchy. That's the main thing to guide his or her actions. And of course, we also have the monarchy, the last element, on all banknotes and on all coins. And if we think about the identity-building role and function of coins and banknotes, this is a very important thing, because you cannot make any payment in Thailand whatsoever, except for credit card, without taking the king into your hand and give it to another person who will receive the cane and put it in the cash register. In offices, countrywide, just consider the left-hand side. What many people don't know who have never worked in the Thai countryside and specifically in the Thai bureaucracy, you will see in offices of high-ranking officials, as well as in all meeting rooms, you will see this arrangement. It's actually a little bit wrong because the flag actually should be on the left-hand side. So the flag, nation, religion, and monarchy. Until these days, civil servants, military, etc., when they conduct meetings or whatever, they do not place their actions into the context of constitutions, of the constitution. The actions of state officials, countrywide, is justified and legitimized by reference to nation, religion, and monarchy. Although in a Western sense, of course, all action by state officials can only be justified by reference to the constitution. In Thailand, this is not the case. To the army, you have, when you look around in Bangkok army camps, you will see that the army, of course, is very strong in promoting nation, religion, and monarchy. And a little bit different here, religions, that refers to the constitutional phrase that the king is defender of religions, not just one. But of course, in the arrangement, you have only Buddhism. There are no signs for Christianity or Muslim or whatever. And people at the end, people as patronizing, paternalist sense, not as independent citizens who are above the military. When Rayut Chanucha came to power, he issued his famous, or should I say infamous, 12 core values. This picture was taken in the school in Thasan in Akonsita Marat. You see here, left, the nation, religion, and then the main thing in the center is always the monarchy. So the first core value that Thai children had to recite before school started was, I love nation, religion, and monarchy, day in, day out. And you might imagine that this kind of practice does leave some traces in the minds of children. The basic model of this whole thing is quite simple. You have three pillars, 1, 2, 3, nation, religion, monarchy. When you ask about what is the foundation for these three pillars, of course the pillars must have a foundation. The foundation for these three pillars is the state apparatus, that is the military and the civil bureaucracy. And what do they support in the end? That is the eternally independent and sovereign Thai nation, Thai country, and the kingdom. So this is a self-contained model, and only beneath a very new model that has nothing to do with the upper level, a new model, a competing model, concerns democracy, constitutions, voters, voting, etc. This upper level model was put into a nice picture by the directorate of the coup plotters. You can see the three pillars here, 1, 2, 3, surrounded by the Thai people. So the basic thing is that Thai people must unite in defending these three pillars. And on top of these pillars, you have the Thai nation. So the Thai nation in its existence depends on people uniting amongst each other and supporting these three pillars. You have these nasty creatures here, three of them, they all had nothing else to do than trying to damage those three pillars. The text here says, Kontai Tukon at the bottom. So every Thai citizen, or every Thai, not citizens, every Thai is a protector of the three principal pillars of the Thai nation. And this was confirmed by Prayut Chan-o-cha, the coup plotter. So it's about love and unity from all Thai citizens. Unity in this context is a key word, that is, all Thais must unite in support of this model. There's no trace whatsoever of constitutionalism. And it very easily leads into something else that Prayut also mentioned, that is a distinction between those people who have love towards our motherland, so people who love the country, love the motherland, love the nation, and then there are those people, very disgusting indeed, people who don't really love the country. That's very bad. So it's not that people are neutral or something. You have people who do not love the country, and they probably fit into this category. You know, those are bastards, and you must somehow deal with these people, because not loving your country is probably the worst thing that, from the perspective of national hegemony, you can ever do. In this sector of Thai political culture, constitutionalism or democracy, for that matter, have no systematic place whatsoever. Constitutions and constitutionalism do not exist in this ideological setup. Finally, the contested nature of constitutionalism is also mentioned in these two quotes. I will not read them, but you can see the distinction, the opposition of nation, religion, monarchy, as opposed to constitution and democracy. And Breton, in the second quote, stresses that constitution and democracy is an emerging idea which has to compete with the traditional idea of nation, religion, and monarchy. And he expressly suspects that these two concepts, or these two ideological complexes, are actually contradictory. So you can not have both together, mix both together. You must basically, in the end, choose one of these models. Of course, now one could imagine the military might be a force that is largely separate from society. With Negrete, who worked on authoritarian regimes and constitution making in South America, he said that if there is a military that does not just want to exert power, but wants to secure a lasting role for itself, wants to carry its reforms over into the period after it will have given power to an elected government, then, in that case, you need societal forces that are in alliance with you. We have already seen that the Thai military is not separate. It has a very deep reach into Thai society at all levels. And this has led to a very thick layer of political culture in Thailand that supports that ideology. When you look at the mass protests of the People's Alliance for Democracy, PAD, that led to the 2006 coup, and to the mass protests by the PDRC, which led to the PDRC as People's Democratic Reform Committee, which led to the coup in 2014, These are the most recent manifestations of the societal connections between the connections between society and the military ideology of nation, religion, monarchy. The PDRC protests in particular were a manifest rejection of constitutionalism. Constitutionalism meaning that all political actors in the polity support and are committed to the constitution as limiting and programming framework for their actions. This meant that during the aborted elections of 2014, a very practical example here, citizens who tried to rely on the constitutional rights had no chance against people whose actions occurred in the context of nation, religion, monarchy. You see this here in this slide. So on the left-hand side, what do we see here? We see people with national flag, with nation, religion, monarchy, using this ideology and the flag in order to prevent people from reaching polling stations. On the right-hand side, we have people who use their citizens' ID cards in order to demand access to polling stations. So you have basically a contradiction between or an opposition of nation, religion, monarchy, and of constitutionalism. It gets even farther than this. The upper picture here says, "Per Chadle Rajabalang," for the nation and the throne. And the picture beneath reads, "Prajachon Kong Pravacha," people of the king. So when you have something like this and these two, it seems that they somehow think that adopting nation, religion, monarchy and the monarchy gives them a higher rank in styling their actions, and that the constitution or constitutionalism in this context has no value. Constitutionalism must wait if people use nation, religion, monarchy or the monarchy as basic motivator for their actions. So it's a contradiction and opposition between nation, religion, monarchy on the one hand side and constitutionalism on the other hand. All this mainly concerns the ideological level and a certain willingness to go along when the military, when you look at these pictures, you can ask yourself directly, why would people in a constitutional democratic system wear t-shirts that do not relate to other citizens within the constitutional order? Why would they wear t-shirts that relate them directly to the king? Why would they say, we are not citizens amongst citizens, but we are people who serve the king? We act for the nation, we act for the monarchy. We don't act for other citizens within the constitutional order. It's a very different outlook to people who wave their ID cards based on constitutional ideas. So the coup, of course, from the point of view of constitutionalism is totally illegitimate. From their perspective, on the left-hand side, a coup is perfectly legitimate and often even necessary because it can save the nation and it can save the monarchy. one element that comes into this is, you can see already from this, you have people supporting this, but when you have a coup, you also need a lot of people who work for the coup plotters. If the military was separate from society, they would have no one to help them. But in Thailand, for the National Legislative Assembly, for the National Reform Committee, for the Constitution Drafting Committee, you have lots of people who come and willingly help those who have abrogated the Constitution and thrown out a democratically elected government. And it's not that you have to push them or to force them, no. They see this as a very good thing to help the military. There's heavy competition and even lobbying to work for the military. So this is something very different what you would expect from people who adhere to constitutionalism and democracy, because they would say a coup under no circumstances can be justified. And we would never betray our ideals and our principles by hate, by helping military dictators. But these people are very willing to do so. In this, from this point of view, it's very foreign to think that a military coup is a suppressive instrument. It's an instrument that restores the honor of the monarchy, the honor of the nation. And for this kind of work, you have what Plato once called true navigators. That is technocrats, academics, and members of non-governmental organizations. Non-governmental organizations, those are not the same like with civil societies. They are not normally or not necessarily forces of democracy. NGOs in this context are forces of dictatorship. So they think that they have the most sophisticated knowledge in all policy areas and are thus actually entitled to determine the direction of the country, but are nastily denied this opportunity. By whom? By whom? By the corrupt and incompetent politicians. So you have this contradiction between the true navigators, the technocrats, etc., and the incompetent politicians. In a sense, actually, this kind of group, which is called a pichon in Thai, have a similar outlook to the military, and that political parties and politicians is a disturbing element in the traditional scheme of things. They do not fit the ordered hierarchy of rank and status, as Göring said in 1981. But the true navigators actually differ in so far as they principally accept, but only principally, accept the necessity of constitutionalism and democracy. They only insist on politicians adopting very similar principles and practices to the technocrats. So politicians are supposed to become elected technocrats. They should not remain politicians. And until this has not been achieved, until politicians have not been turned into even better technocrats, the members of this stratum of apichon feel justified in taking active roles, not only in the direction of the country, but also in determining the rules of the game, for example, in writing constitutions. Fundamental ideas from constitutionalism, such as the sovereignty of the people, are entirely irrelevant in this context. The political culture of these apichon has been formed since the early 1980s with the increasing significance of elections and therefore with the increasing significance of the hated politicians. Thailand's latest three constitutions of 1979, 2007, the draft of 2015, and the document that is currently being drafted are importantly informed by this political worldview. That is, a future 2016 constitution, if it will ever pass a referendum, will to a large extent reflect the political discourse that has been reproduced over and over again in the past 35 years. These are two very influential books from this area, one from 1933, Chantarawong, and the second one is Anegla Otamatat. I'll just summarize the content of these two books. Basically, they say that voters are poor and too stupid. They are they live in rural social conditions that make it impossible for them to reach an independent political decision because they have to act according to the wishes of their patrons and their vote canvassers. Elections are therefore sold. They are substantially manipulated, and the way they thought this could be solved is that the voters should be turned by state economic development policies into middle class people. So when they middle class people, then they would adopt the middle class political ideology and vote independently. We see this nicely. It has continued until today. The protests of the PAD and the PDRC. In the case of PAD, it was the new politics idea. In the PDRC case, it was political reform. You can see here in La Chinawa, with a very insulting prefix for a low status woman. If I call anybody here E Arai, then you would get up and slap me in the face like mad. So it's E No. No is stupid. And the text below says you can be as stupid as you want, but you will always love her. And what you can see here is the buffaloes will always love her. Buffaloes here, the salivating buffaloes, a great insult to the voters, because the voters are portrayed here as gullible buffaloes who would only listen to what the elect says and promises them, and then they will elect her, although she is so stupid and so incompetent. On the right-hand side is a page from a journal from the period of the PDRC protest. It says, one man, one vote cannot yet be used in Thailand. So both elements refer to the fact that one man, one vote, equal citizenship in Thailand cannot work. Under the PAD, they had the idea of coming up with an election system where only 30% of MPs would be elected, 70% appointed. That was finally garbage. But this idea that voters in the countryside cannot be relied on in elections is pervasive in the apichon, in the elite discourse. And it has been transferred to the constitution drafting process. How much time?
I'm getting close to 45 minutes.
Okay. okay, I will skip this. All these ideas about unreliable voters, in that context, the voters were still seen as being able to educate. They should be educated, they should be economic development programs. When you look at the current military regime's idea of closing the socio-economic gap between people in the country, it's still informed by these ideas about voters who are poor and let their votes be bought. But in the end, it seems that they had sort of given up on this idea of educating the ever stupid and gullible voters. So one very famous guy, Anik Lautamatat again, who also was on the committee to draft the constitution, came up with a three-level mixed-member political system. It comprises a monarchy, then the aristocracy, that is the apichon, comprising middle class, educated people, mass media, intellectuals, military, and civil servants, and then democracy. And he himself, of course, would see that he belongs to the aristocracy or to the apichon. Let me see. And this is, so this actually has then become a key problem of Thai constitutionalism. That is, we are confronted with a situation where there are societal forces, especially the military and broader the apichon, against whom autonomous politics cannot prevail, because such influences do not proceed via elections and neither operate in the form of different political parties within the political system, quoting Newman. Under these conditions, constitutions become or may become means of a struggle. A struggle in this context between the apichon and the other groups. And this is exactly what drafting the 2015 and the future 2016 constitutions is all about. That is, the apichon, including the military, operate outside the constitutional political system, and they use the drafting of a new constitution in their struggle against those forces and institutions that Anik, in his model, categorizes as democracy. In other words, what we are witnessing is a class struggle of the apichon against those forces that advocate autonomous politics, that is, democratic politics. In this struggle, the power holders use constitutional law as an important tool. This draft constitution, therefore, represents the seizure of a very substantive part of state power and of the sovereignty of the people by the apichon. In doing this, the military and the drafters act, in Landau's words, in an abusive way, because in their drafts, they will go back behind a standard of democracy that were supposed to be achieved in Thailand already. So before this, you had a certain level of democracy. With a new constitution, you will have a more limited level of democracy in Thailand. And this is called abusive, because it's an intentional act by the military and by the apichon who help the military doing their job. So I think I leave these other things out. Just perhaps a brief note on the last issue. I mentioned the National Reform and Reconciliation Committee. What this would have done as an absolute innovation in Thai constitution making, it would have created a parallel system. You would have had the elected government doing policies and implementing policies. And you would have had a separate national reform committee that would also do policies and implement them. This committee would have consisted of high-ranking military officers, high-ranking bureaucrats, and a number of experts. And the key issue here, besides having a parallel structure of policy making within one political order, would have been that the appointed National Reform Committee was able to impose its will in terms of policy making and in terms of budget requests upon the elected institutions, cabinet and government and the House of Representatives. So if this reform committee was the opinion that this and this policy should be done and we need this amount of money for that, they would send it to the cabinet and the cabinet would say, no, we don't want to do this. Then the reform committee would have deliberated this again, would have confirmed they really want it, and then they would have been able to force the cabinet to do this. They could also directly approach state mechanisms, bureaucracies, ministries, and force them to act upon their proposals. And if they saw that there were certain elements in the elected government, in the House, in the cabinet, etc., that were against some suggestions or proposals they had come up with, they could bring this case to the Constitutional Court and have the Constitutional Court decide who should act according to their proposals. You can see this very nicely in this cartoon. You have Prayut Chan-o-cha, the military dictator, who wants to prolong his power in terms of policy making into the future for 5 or 10 years after an elected government would have come into place. So this will chain the cabinet and the House to the will of the military dictators. The House and the cabinet as elected institutions would not have been independent after the elections. They would have been dependent and would have had to obey the orders of the National Reform Committee. And you see behind two people on the right-hand side, it's Bowansak Uwano, that is the main constitution drafter, smiling broadly, what he would have done. And the left-hand side is Tien Chai. Yeah, the chairperson of the National Reform Committee. And they together hoped that they would be able to push through this arrangement where the military coup plotter, although out of power, would still hold the reins of power in terms of policy making and implementation. And here, if I read this correctly, Anakot Gamuang Thai, that's the future of Thai politics. The future of Thai politics is not that you have an elected cabinet, elected house, determining the fate of the country, the direction of the country, or govern the country, but in fact, behind them, you would have the coup plotters, and they would use change to force the elected institutions to act according to their will. Um, very briefly, the Constitution, when it was passed, you can see some of the Constitution drafters here, and perhaps you get a sense how immensely proud of their work they were. When you look into their Facebooks and all this, what struck me as a person with a democratic constitutional background is always that they have no feeling of shame. They do not feel that they have been part of a suppressive mechanism established by the military rulers. They do not feel that they draw up a constitution that would be imposed on the people, even after elections. No. What they feel is that they have done a great service, a great sacrifice for the nation. To them, the nation is important. The citizens are entirely unimportant. So you have people who act within the framework of nation, religion, monarchy, emphasizing the nation and the work for the nation, but who are totally oblivious to things like sovereignty of the people. So they were very proud and very self-assured in what they have done. There is no tiny piece of doubt in their minds that they have done exactly the right thing at the right time. But of course, other people were not so so impressed. We have Garcia de Chapila up here. He called the Constitution a fruit from a poisonous tree. Poisonous tree, I mean, you get it right. You have the coup plotters as a poisonous tree. The fruit is the Constitution. And so you have a poisonous Constitution falling from the poisonous tree. You would have Jatu Wanchai saying that this constitution is the worst constitution ever drawn up in Thailand. And you have this sticker saying that it's not good, we will not accept it, we will not consider it a law. And in the end, after this constitution was presented to the public, by these proud drafters, who also had included another element to the reform committee, that is, they had added a function to that committee called the crisis committee. And this crisis committee could decide that there is a political crisis in Thailand. And in that case, they could vote to basically abolish the elected government and the elected house and put themselves in place of the elected institutions. So people said that the normal function was like a state within the state. That is, one state competing with the elected state. And the other element, the crisis committee, was like a constitutionalized coup d'etat. Because it's basically the same that a military coup d'etat could do. They could abolish the elected institutions without performing a coup d'etat. And these two things together led to a huge outcry in the public against the constitution. The only people actually who came out in favor was Thao Suban, that is the chairperson of the PDRC protesters. And that was quite logical because the protesters who engineered the coup in 2014 got what they wanted. They got the reform program they wanted, and so they could be quite satisfied with the form and shape of the constitution, but all others basically were quite much in favor, were quite strong against this constitution. Outlook, that's difficult to say at this point, but one thing is that the interim charter mandates certain elements for drafting the constitution, and one element is precisely a reform committee. There must be a committee or must be a mechanism that allows it, the military, to continue their reform policies after an elected government will have been put in place. And Balut Chan Ocha has on three occasions reiterated that this was non-negotiable. There needed to be a committee or a mechanism that would allow the military to push further their reforms after an elected government would have been put in place. And the chairperson of the newly appointed Constitutional Review Committee said, well, yes, we have to do this. We will try not to establish a state within the state, but we also have to follow the rules and the interim charter in devising such a mechanism. And that's a state as it is now. In the next few weeks will show us how the new constitution will play out. Thank you very much.
Michael, for this wide-ranging talk, and I think we're all lucky that the, for various reasons, that the constitution draft got turned down, but one of the pleasant consequences was that it allowed you to offer this more general analysis. I wondered if I could kick off the question and answer, and we have plenty of time for this, but you know, you focused on those who favor this kind of unconstitutional or really anti-constitutional constitutionalism.
Hybrid.
Even hybrid seems generous in that regard. But I wonder if you could say a little bit more about the opponents. You know, you mentioned them occasionally, that, you know, those who use their IDs in protests. We know about the red shirts. We know about the Thaksin supporters. We know that there's a lot of opposition. If you talk a little bit about them, and, you know, we have the strong aristocratic forces, as you talk about, but an equally strong opposition. And then, actually, what I'm most interested in, though, is the group that's in between. Because you mentioned that there are a lot of people supporting the military, but some people who you think might do so, for example, the Democrat Party, has been a little bit critical at times. And there, I think, you find an interesting dilemma that arises from this whole charade of constitutionalism. So, you know, you have the Democrat Party, which is understandably interested in elections, because they're an electorally oriented party, and they're feeling like Abusive, for example, feeling shunted aside, and he's been quite critical of the military. And I think that while it's true, of course, that there are a lot of people who have been collaborating with the military, particularly a lot of academics and NGO activists, some politicians in the Democratic Party, maybe not so much Sutep, but people like Abusive and others, have been more critical, and they have often sort of emphasize the constitutional side of things, the importance of elections and so on. I wondered if you could comment on those forces that are not so completely in line with what you were talking about.
One thing is that the public sphere in Thailand is very limited these days. So you do not have a vibrant public discourse where parties and others can freely discuss issues of what is going on. So what you have in terms of comments by Abusive are ad hoc comments from time to time. You also have a problem in that the Democrat Party, you said the Democrat Party thinks that or this, I'm not so sure, because the Democrat Party has some people in the coup mechanisms. They have also their PDRC branch, which has launched a strong pro-coup campaign via their Blue Sky TV channel. Abusive, I'm very negative about Abusive, I must say. He is an opportunist. He doesn't seem to have a strong principled position, but still wants to have electoral politics one way or another. So I'm not quite sure whether we know very much about what his actual views are, except for those scattered public remarks on certain occasions. Of course, they would like to have an election. That's a raison d'etre. But besides this, whether he has, I mean, he could have come out actually a few times perhaps and support in certain democratic constitutional principles, as even Pua Thai has come out to do so, when though in a weak way. But I'm not so sure whether we can really say that a PSET is a strong proponent of anything, except a strong proponent of having elections in which he can run again.
Three quick questions. Your model, NRM, Nation, Religion, and Monarchy. The monarchy is practically centered on one person, the current king. Is a model of nation, religion, military feasible in the next, say, 5 years? The king disappears, but they have to put someone to stand for monarchy. So meanwhile, the M is a monarchy becomes military. Okay, until they're able to produce a monarch of the same standing as the king. My second question is about the military. The military has a history of being divided. In 1992, when the king tried to mediate in the red shirt protests, one of their leaders was the general also. So is the military united? Would there be within the military, the coup plotters, which are the military, is there someone there or some faction within that that could be, you know, a splitist?
Okay, I didn't get one thing. Who intervened with the red shirts?
I suppose he's talking about Tse Deng.
Yes.
I suppose he's talking about Tse Deng. But it should be pointed out that there's like probably thousands of generals in the Thai military because it's so top heavy, and that he was actually quite a minor general.
Minor or major, it doesn't matter. Yeah. I'm just.
Kind of that it does actually.
Yeah, it does, but you know, you can have a rogue people there.
He did have a small but significant following within the military, but ultimately the fact that he was assassinated proves that he was insignificant enough to be disposed of.
And the third one is, you mentioned the Abhipanatipahat. That includes the intellectuals. The elite that you say, the elite includes in your enumeration, includes the intellectuals. Okay, the intellectuals are a dangerous crowd because, you know, they're the ones who actually inform people to go against. But in your equation, they are part of the Apichon Atipatai. Mm-hmm. So it's not a very kind of safe inclusion. Because these intellectuals are not always a favorable element of the elite.
Okay, the last one first. I mean, I really agree that not all intellectuals or not all academics, which is not the same, there are very few intellectuals in Thailand, but a great number of academics. And of course, when you do when you come up with categories, then you will have some people from the same group that might have a different point of view. It's more a general outline to get a general idea of who is in which, who is to be found in which category. The second thing about the military, in fact, we have a situation at this point where the military is very united, because all the major military actors come from the same group, the Tigers of the East, right? Queen's Guard. So this is one of the big issues, or has been a big issue in Thai military politics for a long time. Last time it occurred, it was in 1991 with a coup, where Class 5 had gained all important positions of power and therefore were able to do their coup quite easily because there were no competing forces. And now we have the Tigers of the East who occupy almost all important positions in the military. I recognize that when the red shirts had their protests, where there was talk about melon soldiers or melon policemen, green out tomato, outside green, inside red. But that was to a large extent based on hope as well. People hoped that there were opposing forces within the armed forces, within the police, that would come to the rescue of the protesters. But it has turned out that that was just that, a hope. But they had not enough power, firepower, manpower, political power to push through their respective visions, if they at all had these visions in the first place. The first issue, turning nation, religion, monarchy into nation, religion, and military. Nation, religion, monarchy is a very long-standing, solid ideological construct that goes back decades. That cannot easily be changed. And certainly the military cannot be put in place of the M. You mentioned that the M is connected very strongly to Queen Bhumibol, and that's quite right. But the question here is broader. That is, the question is, in a general sense, what will the succession bring? If the monarchy is not supported as a concept, but is supported as support for a certain specific monarch. So if we do not have this specific monarch in place, will the ideological construct break down or not? That's a little bit difficult for me to say anything much about this, but I don't want to say anything bad about anybody, and certainly not about any successors. But there is a crown prince. The crown prince has been anointed successor in 1973 or so. So there are some people who would say we want Princess Sigurdon to follow on King Bhumibol. That's impossible because the crown prince has been anointed the next king. So this is as it stands. The next king will be King Vajiralongkorn. And what we can see from current processes is that the military has thrown in its lot with the crown prince. We first had the campaign called Bike for Mum, that is a biking rally countrywide for the Queen. And now the new activity is Bike for Dad. So now they bike, make a biking rally, a bicycle rally for the King on the occasion of his birthday. And when you pass camps by the military, or say specifically the army, you will see pictures of the king, the queen, and the crown prince. That's also an interesting element in your question of are there divisions in the military, because when you pass the camps or the places of the Air Force, for example, they don't have the signs outside, nation, religion, monarchy. They also do not necessarily have pictures of the queen, the king, and the crown prince. But the army very certainly supports the crown prince as the next king. So there is no way, I think, that nation, religion, monarchy can in any way be changed, only that the monarchy part must be reframed, and another person must fill in the shoes of King Bhumibol.
Yeah, who actually sits on this committee that that rejected the draft constitution? And when it did that, is it possible that maybe it was doing the bidding of the military, which doesn't much mind seeing its draft proposals voted down, because that way they can remove power directly and at the same time create this ongoing imagery of constitutional reform? It's difficult for me to imagine that in these times any committee would defy the military and vote down something the military genuinely wanted.
Yeah, that's an interesting important point. It's in my text, but not in my words. It was rejected by 135 to 105 votes, something like this. Mm-hmm. That was a National Reform Assembly. And what was very instructive in the voting pattern was that basically all military members of that assembly or that committee voted against the constitution. That is basically you have a constitution drafting committee appointed by the military, and then you have the military plus other groups on the committee, but the military most notably voted the constitution down. And as Bowen Sahuano said with some resignation afterwards, you know, he said, it's quite natural that soldiers would follow orders of their superiors. So they didn't sit on the committee and thought, that constitution, I don't like it personally, I vote against it. Rather, there seemed to have been a process of lobbying, of coordination, in order to make all military members of that committee vote against the constitution. There was even one member of the constitution drafting committee who was a military man. He could of course not vote against the constitution because he worked closely with Bowen Sahuano. So his choice was to abstain. That was the most he could do. He could not work with Bowen Sahuano for many, many months very closely and then say, I reject the constitution. He had to compromise because his career in the next few years would have been in danger if he had approved the constitution. But he could register his compliance with the views of his superiors by not voting at all or by abstaining. By the way, also interesting is that all the 15 NGO members, they voted all in favor of the constitution.
So the military members, did they give any reason then for voting against the draft? Did they say it was too democratic and too open, or?
I'm not aware of anybody coming out to declare any reasons. I mean, if somebody tells me I have to vote against this, I get the order, and then a person asks me, what were your reasons? That's an awkward situation, right? But it seemed, I mean, there was one speculation making the rounds after the rejection that was what I mentioned, this outcry of the public after the draft became known. That was really an outcry. And there was only, as I mentioned, one single supporting voice. So maybe, just maybe, the military thought that if we give this constitution as it is to the public referendum, we might just fail. And a failed referendum would be like telling the military to leave politics. So maybe they just didn't want to take the risk of being rejected in a referendum. This would also imply a longer period in power. Yes, of course. But that would have been too crude as it means. You cannot have a constitutional drafting committee meeting 158 times, you know. It's more than previous constitutional drafting committees. You put in all this work, and just in order for you to stay in power for a few more months, you cut that process short. That's a weak reason, I think.
I'd just like to take you to task slightly on this idea that there was a lot of public opinion against the draft proposal. Because you said yourself earlier that the public sphere in Thailand is very limited at the moment. The media is very tame. There is, as you said, also and for the likes of the PDRC and for the military in Thailand. So I don't see any reason why those same people who admittedly are largely based in Bangkok, but I don't see any reason why they wouldn't support also this proposed draft. And just to follow up on that also, even if it is true that there was some kind of public outcry or that people would not be accepting of the constitution, would the military really care, given the fact that the coup was also hugely unpopular, but they went ahead with that anyway, and tried to push through the constitution, maybe even without a referendum, which I'm not sure if that was ever finalized or not, whether they would actually have a referendum on the coup. And even if they did, the way that the coup, the constitution in after the 2006 coup was pushed through, it was sometimes said that it was pushed through quite aggressively, even although there was a referendum, but people felt that they had very little choice but to vote yes on it. So I wonder if you'd like to comment on
that. You mentioned that the coup was hugely unpopular. I would doubt that.
It depends on what you're talking about. If you're talking, if you're talking about the country as a whole, then definitely.
Yeah.
But again, like that, it goes back to the question of how do we know these things without kind of electoral mechanisms, without referendum, without some way to accurately gauge people's opinion. How do we know what's popular, what's not?
The second referendum, actually the interim charter, the first version, didn't have a referendum.
For after the 2006?
The interim constitution, the first version, didn't have a referendum.
Oh yeah, okay, so the constitution which was in 2007?
No.
Not the interim one, but the one that was...
The interim constitution of 2014 didn't at first have a referendum. But the constitution drafters, mainly Anit Lautamatat and Bowon Sakubano, wanted to immunize their constitution against any attempts to amend it. One must see that one element in the constitution that is very controversial is it can basically not be amended by elected politicians in parliament. That's basically impossible. And they wanted to add to this public support for the constitution in a referendum. So they added, they amended the interim charter in order to have a referendum. So they could say that first, the amendment procedures say you cannot amend or hardly amend, and you can also not amend because the people approved in a referendum. Then the question was, how would the referendum proceed? And already at that point, it was quite clear that an open process for a referendum would be impossible. Much less than in 2006, where the constitution got through just a little bit more votes than they would have needed. No, I forgot your question.
Well, basically just how do you gauge public opinion in Thailand at the moment, and what makes you so sure that it was such a public outcry against, other than things like social media, which sometimes I fear that we might get involved in a kind of like echo chamber by following kind of like the more kind of democratic side of
when I say outcry, I indeed rely on all published reactions in the newspapers and on social media like Facebook, as the three examples I have given, that even in the official media, Thai language media, as well as English language media, I would say that under the given constraints of public opinion in Thailand, it was an outcry. Simply because, as I said, I can only remember or recall basically one single expressly positive statement in favor of the constitution. All other statements, as far as I recall, were negative.
In your scheme of different social forces, where does Thai business fall? So, do they overwhelmingly back the military and the monarchy, or are there? I mean, the previous prime minister Thaksin, he wasn't necessarily a poor guy, right? So, and also, where does the U.S. military fall? Because I know they have close links with the Thai military. There's annual military exercise, the Operation Cobra, for example. Mm. So, what's the official or unofficial position of the U.S. military?
Well, I'm not an expert in the American military. I only know that until today, the position of the official position of the American government has been quite negative towards the coup. And when the new ambassador reported to the foreign minister of Thailand a few days ago, he made clear that elections should take place as soon as possible. The first thing was...
Where is Thai business for?
Thai business. Well, Thai business is mostly quite close to the elite. Thai business is not an opposing force, so to speak. And many Thai businesses complain, of course, again, against poor performance of the economy and the military regime, so they want them to do something. The military rulers responded by putting some kid, the previous close advisor and minister of Thaksin, in place. But I think the private businesses also value peace and order. So they don't like it very much having columns of protesters running around in Bangkok closing offices and all this. So if that can be stopped, the military did this, they are quite satisfied. And shortly after the coup, they had a conference with Rayot, and they stood in front of one of the military offices in the center, the chief of the law department store, and declared their support for the military coup plotters. So then I think that business is a force for revolution or something. They go along.
They're often a force for bourgeois revolution, right? So often military dictatorships have been overthrown by bourgeois revolutions, so in South Korea, Taiwan, etc.
Well, bourgeois revolution, I'm not so sure. I mean, when you look at Thailand, we had the bourgeois revolution, or say, the uprising in 1973, but that was not business, that was the children of the business. And many of them are now in the pro-military camp, so...
Can I add a point to that? Is one of the things that they do in Thailand is that they interlock the different institutions, and the way that they do that, for example, is on the board of directors of big companies. So you find a lot of the military, a lot of the generals actually sit on the board, either personally or through a proxy, on the board of the big corporations. Mm-hmm. There's also a kind of interlocking of minor royals, blue-blooded aristocrats, who also sit on the board of the institutions. Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of marriage between the three.
There's one small detail. When you go to Thailand, you will see at many big business buildings, the Garuda, you know? And that's given to these companies in return for certain favors they have done to the monarchy. So it's not only that big business is closely connected to military, big business is also very closely connected to the monarchy.
Yeah, if I may go back to the question raised by Mark in the beginning, he asked where is the middle ground and where what motivates the people on the other side, those with the ID cards. I think that one of the elements which you have been underplaying a bit is the role of Thaksin and the party. If that party would be not corrupt, like many others, of course, but being used for populist means, then, of course, that middle ground might have more sympathy and probably also support for the values which you seem to, for good reasons, to propagate. That's constitutionalism, that's real democracy. But many people, I seem to believe, they have their thoughts about the genuine reasons of that movement itself.
Yeah, that's quite true. I also underplay the reasons. I mean, I only mentioned the view of the voters. Mm-hmm. I didn't say that, for example, I didn't say that a lot of the movements we had in the past, be it PAD or be it PDRC, are very much motivated against the so-called Thaksin regime. But even this is problematic because the Thaksin regime is also a discourse that had been launched quite deliberately in 2004, it's the latest already, and it has, so to speak, become quite independent of the actual facts. It's used as a legitimizing discourse in order to achieve certain ends. And of course, I mean, I would have welcomed if Thaksin would have been a very nice, conscious Democrat. I have lived under Thaksin since the very beginning, in 2001. That was a terrible time because the public sphere would narrow down almost every day. To me, Thaksin actually is one of the biggest failures that Thai politics has produced. But on the other hand, those people who use Thaksin and the Thaksin, so-called Thaksin regime, for their own purposes, for pursuing their own political ends, I'm not sure whether I should agree with these people either.
On that not overly optimistic note, again, many thanks, Michael, for this fascinating analysis.